I'm introducing Vilas Patil. He's with Cognizant, who is a platinum sponsor at RCA World Event. Vilas is the practice head for DevOps services for the Cognizant Technology Office. He brings to us 24 years of experience in e-commerce, product development, strategy, and leading P&L in the high-tech industry. He also has 12 years of experience in product development with eBay and 14 years of experience in what we like to refer to as the unicorns, Amazon, Google, eBay, names you're all familiar with. He's based out of the Silicon Valley, Bay Area, and he is going to talk to you today about how to adopt and adapt DevOps in enterprise settings. You heard this morning that Gene Kim talked about the why, but Vilas is here to talk to you about the how. So please give a warm welcome to Vilas Patil.
All right, thank you very much. Thank you. That little bit sounded better than what I had done, but anyway, I'll take it. All right, so practical strategies to get started with DevOps in your organization. This means to say basically in an enterprise setting. So this is really aimed at companies that are quote-unquote the enterprises of the world, who have multiple platforms, multiple systems. You got a little bit of a silo structure that's going on. So it's basically complex and a little bit at scale. So that's what it is. And now if you want to talk about or if you want to adopt DevOps, then what kind of things that you may have to do or go through is really what I want to talk about today. And this is not too much of the prescription. You know, we just want to share some of the experiences that, you know, I have had and my organization have had, really, you know, helping clients go through some of this journey myself. So let me see how this works first. All right, so a little bit about me, and she talked about it. So I think it's been a fun. So working with these webby companies, you know, what Nora just mentioned was a ton of fun. But then when we started talking to different companies, started talking to these different verticals, you know, your healthcare, insurance, and banking, and so on and so forth, we quickly realized that, I mean, everybody talks about this Amazon model, right? Even Gene Kim talked about his Amazon, 11 seconds, and so on and so forth. Now, how do you take those? Can you transplant some of those things that Amazon does and then go to your bank of the world, or go to your healthcare company of the world, or insurance company of the world? You know, and we quickly learned, and I learned personally that, you know, the answer is a little bit no to it. It's hell no in some cases, but in some cases it's a little bit of no. So how do you get started with it? So that's really what we wanted to share with you. Let me go a little bit forward. So this is all about it, right? The DevOps is all about breaking silos, and, you know, you have this little nifty silos that you're seeing, and this is the day two of the conference here. So you must have seen this, you know, three little tall silos, and then the brick walls in between that, and then DevOps is all about breaking that wall there and then getting everybody to work together. It all sounds great, right? And nowadays, I think the narrative is, you know, there is this little bit of Dev on one side and Ops on the other side and showing these little arrows and so on and so forth. That all sounds great. So you must have seen these things, right? This is very common. If not that, you probably would have seen this one. So what's the difference, you might ask? You know, there are two silos, not three. They are green, they are not red. But basically this, right? You go to any DevOps conference, DevOps books, DevOps presentation, this is basically what is it. But then you wonder, this is very easy, right? You get all pumped up, read some books, go back to your organization, and then you wonder, this sounds a little easy. And then you start talking to people. Then you start generating some of the buy-in in your organization. Then you start making your plan. And then the reality sets in. And then you start fielding some of these questions. You know, what is DevOps again? You know, can you tell me in one word? I was with one client, and we got into the meeting, and then the senior executive just walked up and he said, hey, you know, I have to take some call. But anyway, before I go, tell me what is DevOps really? And I have like 30 seconds to think about, oh, is it a methodology or is that something I can buy? And I'm sure, you know, some of these, you have heard some of these narratives before. So what is DevOps again? So that's one question. Do I set up a DevOps as a COE, or is it a team, or is that something that, you know, I need to carve out in my organization? That's the question I get. This one is real, you know, and these are all real questions, by the way. This is what we filtered. This is a large bank from Australia, sent us an email, heard about you, heard about this, heard about your company. By the way, we have a relationship. Can I buy DevOps? I have a little bit of budget, can I buy it? You know, is that a managed service you guys sell? If you are interested in talking to you. And I was like, never heard of that before, but anyway, that's the question. people are busy. That's another complaint that we get, right? Then they don't listen. Then there's a little bit of frustration that keeps going on. Too much politics, man. I mean, this is one thing. And this is what, after Jin Kim's presentation, and I spent an hour with him and talked about this particular topic, as to how do you wish the politics away from some of these organizations, as get your everybody work together, you know, making that silo stuff, you know, together. So that's really a big thing. Nobody talks about it really, but it's there, right? It's there. You got to figure that out. How do you go about it? No one gets it in my organization. A little bit of more frustration around that. You know, what are the steps, by the way? How do I justify the ROI? I mean, these are some of the questions that you have to fill. That's the reality. That's how, you know, now you are wondering as to, okay, my silo thing happened some time back. Now I have this question. How do I answer this question? How do I get my budget? How do I get things started in my company, in my organization? That's the real thing. So this is what worked for us, and this is what I want to really share with you. And probably we'll not talk too much about the why issue. That much. Jean talked about it in the morning, I think very eloquently. He always does that job. That's great. But we'll talk about a couple of thoughts around that. But I want to spend a little bit of time on getting the buy-in for within the organization from all your stakeholders. That's one I want to. And then the third really important step is, how do you keep it moving? Once you are in, once you get started with it, how do you keep it moving? How do you keep it going in your organization? So that's really the three steps that we followed and seem to be working with us. And again, a little bit of a confession for you guys. When we started this about 1.5-2 years ago in my company, and we started helping clients thinking through some of this, this is not how we thought about it in the beginning. You know, this evolved. Because at the time, you know, we would go in a client situation and say that, you know, hey, we know, we understand how Amazon does development, how eBay does development, and how these companies do development. And we'll tell you how to do these things. You know, we'll just bring those practices here. Rude awakening, right? You know, reality for us too. No, it does not work. And clients, when they bring in these questions, how do you answer that? So that's really the first step. And the first thing that we did is modified our own methodology. You know, we really figured out, you know, how do you relate to these customers? How do you relate to some of these people even? So the first step in that is to figuring out the why part here. And again, when you talk about the why part, and again, like, I won't spend much time in this, but a couple of thoughts in this. See, it's not about that, you know, somebody's CTO, CIO, or some senior executive in the management told you, go and implement DevOps in this. That's not really the why. That's not how you want to generate your buy-in. It's really... You know, why, if you are thinking about keys management, for instance, you know, if you want to go faster, why you want to go faster? You know, can you go and talk to business and tell them, if you go faster, these are the good things that are going to happen to you? Can you narrate that? Can you actually relate these things to your business? That's the why part here. So I'll stop at that, but that's really what we want to basically explain there. So that's the first part. The second part is the getting the buy-in, and this is where, you know, we'll talk a little bit more in detail. So there are really five things that that work for us. So first is, you know, you go and start explaining the concept to all the stakeholders. You talk to development, you talk to operations, you talk to production, you talk to, you know, QA, you talk to basically all, these are all the stakeholders that you want to get the buy-in from. Talk to them about the concepts. Don't talk to them in a very standard, you know, in a bookish, jargonish way that, you know, I'm going to implement a deployment management solution. What the heck is that? Now, what is deployment management solution? Tell them what it means to you, right? Tell them that, you know, when the developer stops writing the finishes the code, that code has to sit in some kind of test environment. I'm going to help you to tell you that when the DevOps talks about DevOps deployment automation, it may talk about pushing a button somewhere, and that code magically is going to come out of some kind of repository and then going to go into that test environment. That's deployment automation management for you. So talk to them about the concept. You know, when you talk to them about the end-to-end automation, tell them what that means. Tell them what the continuous delivery mean really. And you have to field questions. You have to answer a lot of difficult questions, in the sense that approvals, for example, and that keeps coming up in our conversation all the time, that, hey, you know, I have this 16 approvals before anything gets approved for my production. Now, how do I get rid of that? There is anxiety in people. You know, if you tell them that this is end-to-end automation, all of this happens automatically, your testing is automatic, your deployment is automatic, and so on and so forth. You think that you are basically talking about some concept, but the way, you know, we learned in the process is that you are actually increasing the anxiety in people, that, you know, they start to think about, hey, you know, if it is automatic, then what's my role in it? How my job is going to change? You know, you talk to the testing people and tell them about automation, they start wondering, what's my role in it? What's my job is going to look like? So that's really the concept that you really need to explain to them in their context. That's important. The second part is the finding the gaps and finding the things that are not probably working properly in the organization. So this is probably start bottom up. So we generally go in and then look at their value stream, you know, how they start developing the code, when the code finishes, how it goes, how it makes the movement throughout the different departments and so on and so forth. So draw a map. We tend to draw a little bit of a nice map. There may be four or five different main flows that are going in there, but each flow we might have their ancillary workflows as well there. So you know, you need to put that onto a paper. And then you know, the second part of this exercise is going to be start putting in some times there. And this is where you know, we get into very interesting conversation. Depending on who you ask in that organization, they will tell you it takes 1 day, 3 days, 5 days, whatever it is. You know, it's basically a range. But anyway, that's important. So try to get those times that they spend in those particular processes there. So that's really important part of it. And this is where you know, we have some of our aha moments, because at the end of this exercise, we present to the executives, this is how your organization look like, these are the gaps, this is what it is. Generally, this is where either we get an aha moment, that aha, this is how we do it. And it looks very super complicated sort of a diagram there. Or the second emotion we largely get it, oh my goodness, I mean, this sucks. Because, you know, when you start putting things on paper like that, the whole map doesn't look that pretty. And example here, we were working with one insurance company out in East Coast. And so we put together this map. It took them about 42 steps to get to production. But that was not the bad news. 42 is a lot of steps, but that was not the bad news. The bad news was they take about 27 steps to figure out what developer is going to work on that particular code. It takes 27 steps. Now, that was happening there. That was there. That was there in that organization all the time. I don't know how many months and years and quarters out there. But when you put it on paper and go and tell them, the CIO and whoever that is, that this is what happened, everybody laughs at it. And, you know, it's just funny at that point in time. But this is important. This is how you generate the buy-in. This, you know, when everybody sees it in a pictorial form or in some kind of chart form, they see it. And that's where you tend to get some buy-in there. Once you create those, then you get all these things together. You know, what we call is the issue tree. You can call it whatever you want. But basically, you know, there's the funny things there. When you talk to these stakeholders, to people, they will tell you a lot of times about the symptoms of the problem, not necessarily the causes of those issues. You got to hear those. Those are important. That's one piece of it. But occasionally you are, I don't know occasionally, but we get into a lot of times. You know, you get into these discussions and conversations where they say, you know what? I'll tell you the real problem behind all of this thing. In my organization, that guy doesn't talk to that guy, and he doesn't like that guy. And that's the real thing. So you get this pseudo root causes as well. Hear that out. Hear that out. Collect it out. And when you collect all these things and put in an issue tree, and the methodology that we follow there is called MESI. And I don't like the name of it, but that is there. My boss used to be a McKinsey partner. So this is the McKinsey way of doing it. It stands for mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive. And that's the list. But the name says MESI. That's what it is. You can call it NICE or whatever it is. But basically, you put together all these issues in it. And there are basically three things that you got to do there. So there are the symptoms that you need to get the buy-in from this individual stakeholder. Then there are these root causes of it that you need to relate to. And that's your experience. That's how you know you basically synthesize the information. And then the most important part is the solutions part. That is where the solutions need to get injected into the whole conversation and the process. That's where we start talking about, oh, I need to automate this release management process. That's where this solution perhaps would work. One piece of learning that we had along the process is that don't talk about the tools upfront. You know, when you talk about the enterprise, you talk about the CIOs and the CTOs, you talk about the tools upfront. I'm a consultant. I work for the consulting company. You don't want to lose the customer. You don't lose your audience right there. Right? The moment you start talking about, hey, this is new tool, you know, CA, IBM, whatever it is, new tool that I want to come in, 9 out of 10 times the CIOs retorted back to us saying that, you know, I have plenty of tools already in my organizations. Are you trying to tell me that I need to buy yet another tool here? So, you know, don't talk about the tools there yet, just yet. It comes later, not there. The wrong time to talk about it. The next important piece of that is the measurement of it. You need to figure out, you need to start thinking about the metrics and how you're going to measure these things, how you're going to measure some of these changes that are going to happen in the cycle times and so on and so forth. And, you know, how will your boss know that the things have improved or not? Because chances are that, you know, you put all these things together, everything is perfect, your execution is nice, some of the things may not improve. You want to know what doesn't improve. Right? It's as simple as that. It's very common sense there. But very often we see that the measurements are not properly done. They are not even there. Some of the CIOs, in fact, don't even get proper reports from their organization and so on and so forth. We need to think about how we are going to measure it, what we are going to measure, what matters to that organization. That also needs to be figured out at that point in time. So all of this had to come together. It's a lot of thought there, and we will have to do some investment. We generally find that this is one area where there is generally a little bit underinvested in the process. So we need to make a case for that investment a little bit. And some tip for you guys, you know, if you want to get funding for the next project, these things help. You know, this is how you get the funding. You know, if you show your boss that these are the five things that got improved, these two things that did not improve, I need more money to kind of fix those things, that's how you get your budget. So measurement is really, really important. So that's a big deal. And then finally, once you have the solutions and symptoms, causes, so on and so forth, you write the user stories. And you know, those of you who are doing agile development, you know already what I'm talking about, the epics and the user stories and so on and so forth. But those of you who are just getting started with it, they're basically, you have to turn these solutions into the big things that you want to implement, and then break those big things down into a smaller size project that you can distribute around in the organization. Chances are that in an enterprise, you're not going to have one DevOps team that is going to implement every single solution. You will have to get these different solutions to different departments and then kind of have a master plan back of it to kind of put all these things together. So your plan, that issue tree and everything acts more of a master plan, but then you have to distribute these user stories back to these each stakeholders, departments, and then get them to do those jobs there. So that's really important. That's how you really get moving. One other thing that we do usually, and then we find, again, after learning, useful, is that we start doing a pilot project for these guys. You know, we challenge the customers. Figure out two or three or four pilot projects in your organizations where some of these issues, solutions, recommendations can be deployed. And then those two, three, four, five projects basically become your shiny objects in your organizations to tell them, hey, this is how you do the things, and these are the successful in your context. Because a lot of times, you know, in the beginning, when we talk about DevOps and talk about this automation and so on and so forth, a few comments that we get, something like this, that, oh, this sounds great on paper, but my organization, my world is a little bit more complicated, a little bit more complex. This is not going to work. So basically, they are skeptical about it. So when you develop these pilot projects in their context, in their organization, this is the tool for you to kind of take it forward, and then now they are convinced. Now they are converted. But that's what you want. And then those three, four pilot projects can become 8 or 10 projects and 15 projects and so on and so forth. So that's kind of a way to propagate it to the entire enterprise. So that's really what this five-step process is. And the last thing is, you know, you have to keep improving. You have to keep it going. Now, again, we will not spend too much time here on this one, but basically once you do these first pilot projects and even you know, your first 10 projects and so on, you need to figure out, you know, how do I keep improving? Because this is not where it stops, right? You want to start small somewhere. You have to improve maybe few processes, but your chances are you may not be able to get to the every single process in your organization. You have to put in a structure there that will keep this moving, keep this going. Now, is that a COE that you need to set up? Is that a team that you need to set up? There are debates about that, and I've written some presentations about it, and they are on the web. Finally, it boils down to, you know, how your organizations want to deal with it. But almost always, one thing which is common, you know, for the companies that I have seen at least, where things moved forward once the initial hysteria kind of goes away, is that you want to have a champion, you want to have executive sponsor that will take this a little bit forward, and then you have to have actual doers, actual practitioner. They may be in the development, they may be in the operations, they may be elsewhere, wherever they are, but there has to be some practitioner out there to keep it moving and then keep going. So that's really it. So these are the three steps really that kind of work for us. This is what Cognizant wants us to show you, but this is $9 billion company, and then go have fun with it. So that's all from my side. All right? Thank you.